Good morning. Welcome to Hope Fellowship of Somerset. We meet every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. for fellowship. Today we're running a little late. Sorry about that. We're going to be talking today about how Yeshua appeared as Elohim's suffering servant. Israel's leadership elite rejected him as Elohim's lamb, and we'll go into the reason for that. Today is April 5th, 2020. Today is communion for those of you who join us online. Father, we thank you for your word. Your word is always true. We thank you for history that we can go back to see how things were originally done to glorify your name. As we talk about the Pesach Passover lamb, we pray that we will learn from the types and shadows that are in him. And we pray as we understand how his work of grace has worked in our lives, that we will receive his grace and walk in your and in your grace. In Yeshua's name we pray, amen. Well, I never start a sermon without a joke. Some are funny, some not so much. Today is guilty, guaranteed. A murder trial went on for 4 weeks with testimony from both sides. Finally, the jury was sequestered to determine the verdict. After 2 days, the jury had reached a decision to acquit the prisoner. The judge asked, "What possible reason could you have for acquitting the prisoner?" The foreman responded to the judge, "Insanity, Your Honor." Then the judge responded, "Wait, what? All 12 of you were driven insane?" I got a courtesy laugh. At this point, I'm going to be playing some music for everyone to hear.
Messiah has come. It says in his word to cleanse everyone. Atonement he made, iniquity bore, that we can find life with him evermore. The sacrifice lamb has been slain, its blood on the altar was stained to wipe away time pain, to bring hope eternal. Salvation has come to the world, God's own Son to the world, Jesus the one for the world, Yeshua is here. The prophets of old speak much of Messiah. His death is foretold, the purpose is clear. Isaiah did say, "'Twas for an atonement, to give us a way that leads not to death. The sacrifice now has been slain, his blood on the altar has stained, to wipe away guilt and pain, to bring hope eternal. Salvation has come to the world, God's own Son to the world, Jesus, the one for the world, Yeshua is He. So, brothers of mine, look not to yourself, for we are but one. We've broken the law, but He paid our debt, that we can find life by Yeshua's death. The sacrifice lamb has been slain, His blood on the altar to us say, to wipe away guilt and pain, to bring hope eternal. So final atonement has come and brought us new home by God's Son. If you will believe in your heart, Yeshua, you'll know.
This is by far and wide one of my favorite worship songs from Messianic believers. I first learned of Lamb back in the late 70s, met them. They even let me play along with them when I was still good at playing the guitar. Now, their music is on YouTube, and for all intents and purposes, if you want to listen to good Hebrew Christian worship, go to YouTube. You'll find hours upon hours upon hours of it. Look for Lamb. Look for Paul Wilbur. Look for others like him, or like them, because some of the most influential and powerful worship music I have ever heard comes from Israel and Messianic believers. Today's scripture reading is 1 Peter 1:18 through 25. It is, "For you know that Elohim paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And the ransom He paid was not mere gold or silver. It was the precious blood of Messiah, the sinless, spotless Lamb of Elohim. Elohim chose Him as your ransom long before the universe began, but He has now revealed Him to you in these last days. Through Messiah you have come to trust in Elohim, and you have placed your faith in and hope in Elohim because He raised Messiah from the dead and gave Him great glory. You were cleansed from your sins when you obeyed the truth. So now you must show sincere love to each other as brothers and sisters. Love each other deeply with all your heart, for you have been born again, but not to a life that will quickly end. Your new life will last forever, because it comes from the eternal living word of Elohim. As the scriptures say, people are like grass, their beauty is like a flower in the field. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of Yahweh remains forever. And the word is the good news that was preached to you." Father, as I preach this word, I pray that I will preach it in power, that I will be a conduit of your love, that I will be a conduit of truth, and that if there's anything in this sermon that you don't want me to say or preach, bring it to my mind before I get to it, so that I won't preach or teach something that is not of you. We pray these things and seal them in Yeshua's name. And for all of our friends online who are watching us, bless them with this sermon. Encourage them and strengthen them with this sermon. Our friends in Uganda, we pray for that they will hear this and be encouraged, especially in the days that we're living. For our friends who are in Pakistan, Indonesia, and India, we pray that they will listen and be encouraged with the word of truth that comes from this pulpit. For our friends who are in Cuba, we pray that they will be encouraged and strengthened, and remember that Messiah is coming soon, so what you're facing now is only a short time, but we will have eternity in heaven as brothers and sisters, husbands and wives, and children. Be glorified, Father, we pray in Yeshua's name. Amen. Yahweh's Pesach festival, which we call Passover in English, began on Sunday when Messiah was scrutinized by the priest. Sunday was not called Sunday in Israel. In fact, they don't have days for names for the days. They have numbers. Sunday is 1, Monday is 2, Tuesday is 3, Wednesday is 4, on up to the seventh day, which is Shabbat. Last week, we began a series on Psalm 91. It will resume after the Pesach festival. Many in our assembly still do not understand how the Passover season plays such a pivotal role in our lives. Over the next two Sundays, we will cover the prophetic types and shadows of Elohim's sacrificial lamb. Messiah Yeshua is the lamb who was slain from before the foundation of the universe. 1 Peter 1:18 through 20 again tells us, "You know that Elohim paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Messiah, the sinless, spotless Lamb of Elohim. Yahweh chose him as your ransom long before the universe began. But now in these last days, he has revealed to you, he has been revealed for your sake." We have entered the Passover season, which was fulfilled prophetically by Yeshua the Messiah in 30 CE. His mission was to shed his blood and deliver humanity from sin's consequence of death. The Passover festival has been celebrated from perpetuity until Yahweh's suffering servant, our Master Yeshua, fulfilled it in his death, burial, and resurrection as Elohim's sacrificial lamb. The people of Israel sacrificed a lamb and placed its blood on around three places on their doorsteps. Where the lamb's blood was applied symbolized the three crosses of Golgotha in 30 CE. Yahweh's death angel passed over the homes of the Jews protected by the lamb's blood. All the Egyptian firstborn males and their animals were killed in the place that were not protected. The people of Israel obeyed Yahweh by brushing the lamb's blood with hyssop on the door posts. They were protected from Yahweh's death angel. Believers are protected by the lamb's blood. Hebrews 9:24 through 26 proclaims, "Messiah did not enter into a holy place made with human hands, which was only a copy of the true one in heaven. He entered into heaven itself to appear now before Elohim on our behalf. And he did not enter heaven to offer himself again and again, like the high priest here on earth who enters the Holy of Holies year after year with the blood of an animal. If that had been necessary, Messiah would have had to die again and again ever since the universe began. But now, once for all time, he has appeared at the end of the age to remove sin by his own death as a sacrifice." The Passover festival and its supper symbolizes our protection from Yahweh's judgment and wrath. It was provided to us through the shed blood of Messiah Yeshua, Elohim's sacrificial lamb. 1 Peter 1:18 and 19 reveals, "For you know that Yahweh paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And the ransom he paid was not mere gold or silver. It was the precious blood of Messiah, the sinless Lamb of Elohim." As you've probably noticed, I've got the same scriptures over and over again. It's because this is a point that cannot be emphasized enough. Yahweh uses prophetic events on his creation calendar through Israel's festivals to reveal his universal plans for the humanity he created. He uses past events to reveal these prophetic events. Yahweh established the festivals of Israel, all intrinsically linked to Messiah's mission and work. The seven festivals of Israel are also intrinsically linked to our present last days prophetic timelines. Jewish tradition says prophecy has multiple layers of fulfillments until their ultimate fulfillment. The first four festivals were celebrated and fulfilled on the actual feast days according to Torah calendar. That's also the creation calendar and the Jewish calendar. Isaiah 28, 9 and 10 declares, "To whom will he teach knowledge, and to whom will he explain the message? Those who are weaned from the milk, those taken from the breast. For it is precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little." Throughout Scripture, Messiah has been revealed in types and shadows. It began with Yahweh Elohim's promise to Eve in Genesis 3:15 that her descendant, not descendants, her descendant would crush Satan's power and rule. Genesis 3:14 and 15 tells us, "Yahweh Elohim said to the snake," or Satan, "because you have done this, you are cursed more than all the wild or domestic animals. You will crawl on your belly. You will be the lowest of animals as long as you live. I will make you and the woman hostile toward each other. I will make your descendants and her descendant," referring to Miriam or Mary, "hostile toward each other. He will crush your head, and you will bruise his heel." The Jewish religious elite were proclaimed the children of Satan by Messiah himself. They were called this by Yahweh Elohim himself centuries before Messiah's death, burial, and resurrection. It was Israel's religious elite who called for Messiah's death. There were unintended consequences over their outcries. They had no idea how his death, burial, and resurrection would affect them. 1 Corinthians 2:9 and 10 declares, "The rulers of this world have not understood it. If they had, they would not have crucified our glorious Adonai." That is what the scriptures mean when they say, "No eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what Yahweh has prepared for those who love him." Israel's religious elite ordered Messiah's death to Pontius Pilate. They wouldn't have ordered it if they had known what his victory would cost them. They had no clue who they dealt with. In fact, they would not have ordered Pontius Pilate to call for Messiah's crucifixion if they had known it would destroy their power. This is the essence of Passover and its types and shadows. Early prophetic events are called shadows. Prophetic fulfillments are called types. When types are ultimately fulfilled, they are often more intense and more important than the original prophetic events. The first four festivals were celebrated and fulfilled by Messiah on the exact days and times they were observed in 30 CE. They were Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, and Pentecost. It is important to understand that Yahweh's seven festivals symbolize a sequence of prophetic events that are set in chronological order by Elohim and will literally take place in the same exact order. And that goes to point one. Yeshua, Elohim's Passover lamb, shed his blood and through it gave us his eternal life. His obedience to submit to his brutal death paid sin's ransom. Western understanding of prophecy involves prediction and fulfillment. But Hebraic understanding of prophecy states that patterns repeat one or more times until its ultimate fulfillment takes place. The Jewish thought of biblical prophecy revolves around repeated historical patterns. All fulfillment of minor prophetic events have ultimate fulfillments which surround Yahweh's prophetic festivals. In Western theology, a type is a prophetic and an historical event providing a continuity to one or more events yet to come. Prophetic events aren't always understood during their original fulfillment. Deuteronomy 16:16 says, "Each year, every man in Israel must celebrate these three festivals: the festival of unleavened bread, the festival of harvest, and the festival of shelters. On each of these occasions, all men must appear before Yahweh, your Yahweh, at the place he chooses, but they must not appear before Yahweh without a gift for him." Unleavened bread is seen as a type of removing sin from Israel. The harvest festival of Pentecost is Israel's birth festival and was a type of the future outpouring of Elohim's Holy Spirit on believers. The festival of shelters, called Sukkot and Tabernacles, is a type of Messiah's millennial reign on the earth, in this present dimension of space, time, and matter, alongside his beautiful bride. That's us, folks. One thing these festivals have in common is giving. When observing these festivals, also called the pilgrimage festivals, we must not enter worship tight-fisted but with a joyful spirit of generosity. Prophecy doesn't make sense to Western minds without understanding Yahweh's seven festivals, which are chronological in his prophetic creation calendar, which was established in Yahweh's word. According to Torah calendar, Israel met with Moses at Mount Sinai in 1437 BCE, after Yahweh gave Israel his covenant of moral laws, the Esoret HaDevarot, and instituted Yahweh's seven festivals. The Esoret HaDevarot, which are commonly called the Ten Commandments, actually contains a set of biblical principles relating to Jewish ethics and worship. This took place after Israel observed Pesach. The Ten Commandments were communicated by Yahweh Elohim to the people of Israel at Mount Sinai 40 days after their exodus from Egypt. The event is known as the giving of the Torah. Yahweh exhorts his covenant people, Jews and Messianic followers, to join him in celebrating his seven festivals. The seven festivals will continue to be celebrated throughout Messiah's millennial reign. Yahweh's seven festivals are types and shadows of Yahweh's universal plans for the redemption, sanctification, and glorification of his covenant people, Messianic and non-Jewish believers alike. Yahweh's festivals provide types of his plan of redemption by our Master, Messiah Yeshua. These types are only shadows of the universal renewal of all things from Yahweh's Messiah, Yeshua. Revelation 21:5 says, "And the one sitting on the throne said, 'Look, I am making everything new.' And he said to me, 'Write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true.'" Yahweh's plan of redemption was planned out even before the foundation of the universe the first foundations of the universe were laid. It is centered on the life and work of Adonai, our sovereign master, Messiah Yeshua. The seven festivals are structured to provide us a roadmap of last day's prophetic events and give us hope of being included in the plans and destinies that Yahweh has provided for all believers. These celebrations always take place at Yahweh's command according to his prophetic creation calendar. Studying the significance of Yahweh's festivals guides our last day's prophetic understanding. Non-Jewish believers aren't required to observe these festivals. Every believer should study them. They are not merely historical events of Israel's past. They are prophetic timelines for our future. Messiah observed the festivals and performed miracles at them. He fulfilled the first four, moved in the miraculous in them, and revealed in them his royal power as Elohim's mighty right arm. John 12:37-38 reveals, "Despite all the miracles, miraculous signs Yeshua had done, most of the people still did not believe in him. This is exactly what Isaiah the prophet had prophesied. Yahweh, who has believed our message? To whom has Yahweh revealed his powerful arm? Messiah came to his humanity as the Son of Man, the one and only Son of Yahweh, Elohim's mighty right arm in human form. He placed himself in the role of Elohim's sacrificial lamb. Psalm 118, 14 through 16 proclaims, Yah is my strength and song. He has become my Yeshua. The voice of rejoicing and Yeshua is in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of Yahweh does valiantly. The right hand of Yahweh is exalted. The right hand of Yahweh does valiantly. Messiah Yeshua was Elohim's sacrificial lamb, from which the Passover lamb of Israel is a type and shadow, and veiled within its celebration gives us a demonstration of his substitutionary work. Messiah was wrapped in a burial cloth, hidden in a rich man's tomb, and rose from the dead on the third day, according to Yahweh's prophetic word. He resurrected on first fruits, the day of salvation. Prophetic scripture describes the Passover lamb as a type of Messiah in great detail. From the way the lamb is prepared to its placement on the spit, we see Messiah's sacrificial death played out. Exodus 12 describes the criteria of the Passover lamb and how it is to be slain. Prophetically, it mirrors the sequence of events of Messiah's sacrificial death on the top of Golgotha. On the cross on the top of Golgotha. For 4 days, each lamb will live with each Jewish family as a family member before it is slain. Messiah presented himself as a sacrificial lamb to his relatives when he rode into Jerusalem. Exodus 12:2-6 explains, on the 10th day of this month, each man must take a lamb or a young goat for his family, one animal per household. A household may be too small to eat a whole animal. That household and the one next door can share the one animal. Choose your animal based on the number of people and what each person can eat. Your animal must be a one-year-old male that has no defects. You may choose a lamb or a young goat. Take care of it, meaning love it, meaning consider it as part of your family, until the 14th day of this month. On the day of its sacrifice, the family would prepare the lamb for sacrifice and prepare the food that was eaten before the sacrifice. It became known as Preparation Day, which was the day Messiah died. The Passover lamb is meek and quiet when it is led to sacrifice. Messiah also suffered without any complaint. He didn't cry out that his punishment was unfair, because it was his salvation mission. For the purpose of describing Messiah's work and mission, we must look at Isaiah 50, 52, and 53 to see Messiah, Elohim's sacrificial lamb, whose primary purpose was to wash away humanity's sin. Yeshua will return as our conquering king on Yom Kippur, following the 7-year tribulation period. While we are waiting to be gathered, we must stay rapture ready as we watch fulfilled prophecy. And that goes to point two. Jewish and non-Jewish leaders thought that Messiah was the ultimate failure, but he proved to be the ultimate success as Elohim's Passover lamb. Humanity's leadership elite continues to be amazed that Messiah, the Prince of Heaven, would let himself be handed over to the humanity he created to be tortured, abused, beaten, and crucified. Isaiah 52, 14, and 15 prophesies, but many were amazed when they saw him. His face was so disfigured he seemed hardly human, and from his appearance one would scarcely know he was a man. And he will startle many nations. Kings will stand speechless in his presence. For they will see what they had not been told. They will understand what they had not heard about. Humanity cannot believe that the Prince of Heaven, its Creator, would willingly hand himself over for judgment and death in order to be its ultimate rescuer from sin's consequence and death. Despite Messiah's disfigurement through abuse and his shameful death on Calvary's cross, he will reappear as our powerful conquering king who will bring his judgment on the fallen world leaders. Romans 14:11 declares, "For the scriptures say, as surely as I live, says Adonai, every knee will bend to me, and every tongue will confess and give praise to Yahweh because of me." Although Messiah was disfigured and hardly identifiable as a human being on the cross, eventually all kings and political leaders will recognize him in his glory and honor him as their master. Isaiah 52:13 tells us, "Behold, my servant will deal wisely. He will be exalted and lifted up and will be very high." Through Isaiah, Yahweh both introduced his suffering servant as his Messiah and prophesied that his humiliation would end with Messiah's return to prominence and exaltation at his right hand. Hebrews 8:1 and 2 declares, "We have a high priest who sat down in the place of honor beside the throne of the majestic Elohim in heaven. There he ministers in the heavenly tabernacle, the true place of worship that was built by Yahweh and not by human hands. Messiah's suffering brought reconciliation between Yahweh and fallen humanity through his shed blood. Yeshua ultimately fulfilled the Passover festival described in Yahweh's prophetic word." Colossians 1:20 through 22 encourages, "For Elohim in all his fullness was pleased to live in Messiah, and through him Elohim reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Messiah's blood on the cross. This includes you who were once far away from Elohim. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. Yet now he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Messiah in his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault." Prophetic passages in Isaiah demonstrate that it is indeed Yeshua, our Messiah, who is Yahweh's suffering servant, as seen in Matthew through John, as well as in Peter's, Paul's, and John's letters. 40 days after Messiah accomplished cleansing the universe of sin, he ascended back to heaven in triumph and was exalted to his heavenly position at the right hand of heaven's majesty. Colossians 3:1-4 proclaims, "Since you have been raised to new life with Messiah, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Messiah sits in the place of honor at Elohim's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Messiah in Elohim. And when Messiah, who is your life, is revealed to the world, you will share in all his glory." New Covenant apostles quote from Isaiah 52 and 53 to demonstrate from those prophetic passages that the scope of Messiah's mission, passion, death, and resurrection was fulfilled in Yeshua. 1 Peter 2:21 through 24 exhorts us, "For Yahweh called you to do good, even if it means suffering, just as Messiah suffered for you. He is your example, and you must follow in his steps. He never sinned, nor never deceived anyone. He did not retaliate when he was insulted, or threaten revenge when he suffered. He left his case in the hands of Yahweh, who judges fairly. He personally carried our sins in his body on the cross so that we can be dead to sin and live for what is right. By his wounds, you were healed." We have an example from Paul exhorting us to be humble and honest in our self-evaluations and to be like Messiah in lifestyle and attitude by applying Isaiah 53 to a sacrificial death on the cross. Philippians 2:5 through 11 proclaims Messiah, "You must have the same attitude that Messiah Yeshua had. Though he was Elohim, he did not think of equality with Elohim as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to Elohim and died a criminal's death on the cross." Therefore, Elohim elevated him to the place of the highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Yeshua every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Messiah Yeshua is sovereign Adonai, to the glory of Yahweh the Father. Isaiah presented Yahweh's suffering servant as the Holy One, who would shed his blood for the sins of humanity at his first advent, and then would return as conquering king in the last days. Isaiah 53:1 asks, "Who has believed our message? To whom has Yahweh revealed his powerful arm?" Who has believed our message? Our Adonai and Master Yeshua proved that he is the Messiah when he quoted from this in John 12, though he was ultimately rejected as he hung on Calvary's cross. The question was ultimately directed at Israel's ruling leadership, the Sanhedrin. They rejected Yahweh's suffering servant and his sacrificial work because they wanted a conquering king. The problem is the package he arrived in, fulfilling Isaiah 52. Messiah is introduced as Elohim's suffering servant, but not Israel's conquering king. So he was rejected by Israel's leadership elite. This is Messiah Yeshua's good news message. His sacrificial death, burial, and resurrection as Elohim's sacrificial lamb was completely successful in paying for the ransom of humanity's sin. Because of his sacrifice, Messiah was restored to his original position at majestic Elohim's right hand. As heaven's king, Messiah's power is demonstrated by his miraculous work of salvation. And that goes to the final point. Israel's leaders were looking for a conquering king, but not a suffering savior. They rejected their true Messiah when he appeared to wash away all sin. To Israel's leaders, Messiah appeared to be weak and helpless before them. Who they actually saw and what they understood stands in preconceived contrast to what their Messiah was supposed to be. Daniel 9:25 and 26 proclaims, "Now listen and understand. Seven sets of 7 years, 483 prophetic years, and plus 62 sets of 7 years, will pass from the time the command is given to rebuild Jerusalem until the Prince of Heaven, King David's descendant, Messiah, appears. Jerusalem will be rebuilt with streets and strong defenses, despite the perilous times. After this, a set of 62 sets of 7 years, the Messiah will be killed, appearing to have accomplished nothing." The Prince, Messiah, appeared in Jerusalem 483 years to the day of this prophecy to die for the people of Israel. His relatives, as well as all who would put their trust in him for salvation alone. 483 years after Daniel gave this prophecy to the day, Yeshua rode triumphantly into Jerusalem on a young white donkey and presented himself as the atoning, suffering servant. 4 days later, he died. As in Daniel 9 prophesied, our Messiah appeared to have accomplished nothing. But the reality is that he accomplished his mission to give up his life for humanity and pay for its sins from all eras. It has been calculated by Dr. Hugh Ross that when Messiah hung on Calvary's cross, he traveled through 11 dimensions of space, time, and matter to completely destroy the power of sin. Dr. Hugh Ross is an astrophysicist and best-selling author. He travels worldwide proclaiming the compatibility and advancement of scientific discoveries with the timeless truths of Christianity. It was in these 11 dimensions, he wrote about these dimensions in his book, The Creator and the Cosmos. He explained Elohim is not constrained by the same four basic time and space dimensions humanity is constrained to. It was in these 11 dimensions of space, time, and matter that Messiah's shed blood was spent to pay the ransom for all of humanity to have the ability to put their trust in him for salvation. Hebrews 2:9-13 says, "What we do see is Yeshua, for who for a little time was given a position a little lower than the angels, and because he suffered death for us, he is now crowned with glory and honor. Yes, by Yahweh's grace, Yeshua tasted death for everyone. Yahweh, for whom and through whom everything was made, chose to bring many children into glory. And it was only right that he should make Yeshua, through his suffering, a perfect leader, fit to bring them into their salvation. So now Yeshua and the ones he makes holy have the same Father. That is why Yeshua is not ashamed to call them his brothers and sisters. For he said to Yahweh, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. I will praise you among your assembled people. He also said, I will put my trust in him, that is, I and the children of that Yahweh has given me. When Messiah originally appeared to Israel, she was spiritually as dry as a hot desert, which makes it impossible to grow vegetation in its arid environment, and was susceptible to death spiritually. Isaiah 53:2 says, My servant grew up in Yahweh's presence like a tender green shoot, like a root in dry ground. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. Messiah grew in power, authority, and stature while Israel looked to him for leadership in another form, a king. They didn't want a suffering savior, so Israel rejected him as her messianic king. Luke 2:52 tells us, Yeshua the Messiah grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with Elohim and all the people. The evil and idolatrous kings, political leaders, and unfaithful priests who lived at the time of Yahweh's prophets would not listen or believe their message. They faced his judgment. Matthew 7:28 and 29 declares, When Yeshua had finished saying these things about the future, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, for he taught with authority, quite unlike their teachers of religious law. The New Covenant writers virtually said nothing about Messiah's physical appearance. Rather, they focused on Messiah's moral beauty and excellence found in his divine attributes and character. The people of Israel in Yeshua's time were looking for their messianic king. Messiah Yeshua was sought out not because of his sterling good looks, but for his compassion, teaching, and miracles. Elohim's sacrificial lamb didn't carry himself with regal splendor as the kings of his days did to attract us to him, though they and we desire physically attractive and personally charismatic leaders. According to Scripture, Messiah wasn't amazingly attractive physically. It was the message he preached, the miracles he performed, and the mercy he exercised which brought people to him. 1 Samuel 16:7 reveals, Yahweh said to Samuel, Don't judge by his appearance or height, for I have rejected him. Yahweh doesn't see things the way you see them. People judge by outward appearance, but Yahweh looks at the heart. This was referring to King David's brothers. In conclusion, clearing a path for royalty or conquering kings by placing palm branches in front of their horses or donkeys was a traditional way to show them honor or surrender as they rode into their cities. Palm Sunday was given its name because Jews greeted Yeshua by laying palms and branches along with their coats on his messianic axis on the first day of Pesach week, which was Sunday. All four Good News books record that Yeshua was given this honor by visiting crowds as he entered Jerusalem along the Via della Rosa, the messianic axis, which was Messiah's path to the temple. The Yeshua, the true King of Israel, came to pay the ransom for humanity's sin and the consequences it required to give each person who puts their trust in him for salvation eternal life with him forever. Messiah's death was encapsulated in his birth. As Yahweh's sinless lamb, Yeshua gave up his life for humanity, and he gave those who trust him the privilege to live. I trust him the privilege to live with him forever in heaven. Messiah prayed that his abuse, loneliness, pain, and death would pass from his hands. He left his fate in his Father's hands and was received back to his eternal position at the right hand of power. Messiah, as the suffering servant, was beaten and mocked unmercifully in the court where he was put on trial. In effect, Messiah was without protection and without justice as he was taken away. The life of Messiah was given through suffering and shedding his precious blood. He provided a substitute for justification and eternal life that sinful humanity could not find Elohim on its own. Messiah was treated like a criminal on the cross, and he bore humanity's many sins. He was hung between two murderous thieves, yet Yahweh counted Yeshua as his triumphant and mighty king. Next week, I will finish part two of this Passover sermon series. The following Sunday, if our Master is willing, I will be teaching on the communion of the Master's table. After that, we will get back to Psalm 91. In benediction, 1 Corinthians 1:18, the message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction, but we who are being saved know it is the very power of Yahweh. Yahweh has blessed you and will protect you. Yahweh has smiled on you and has been gracious to you. Yahweh has shown you his favor and will give you his shalom, perfect and complete peace. Amen, amen, and amen.